Tisdale?
Gotta set up my tripod.
How you been?
Logan, haven't seen you in a while.
I know, it's been a while. You been doing good?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Hey, I was looking for the town mayor.
All right.
Oh, okay, yeah. Okay.
Say what else? I'm home.
Yeah, you should be.
Oh, still over there?
Yeah.
Need a bigger tripod in here.
I know the size was limited by this man across the street named Mayor H. Ford Gray. And it was a state case. It was real interesting. And he tried to kick this lady out over there. Was worried about the safety of this tripod, you know. So this tripod has been identified and has been cleared. We know that this tripod is safe. The state of Georgia, Sam Owens, has identified it. And he likes it too.
If it falls over, it won't hurt you.
Well, you tell.
You'd have to pick it up and swing it at
you. You tell that knucklehead next door that information. I tell you, he's hard-headed, but he's been at it for 60 years, so it's hard to get anything across.
This is actually my
objection.
We're in the 19th.
You can hear that band jam music.
The 1950s.
That's how our,
the 1950s.
Our 20s.
Partially.
That's a different song.
Three years ago.
Good morning. My name is Shannon Westbrook. I'm the Forsyth County Ethics Panel Clerk. Today is Friday, May 5th, 2017. I call this meeting to order at 10:34 a.m. Those in attendance are panelists Ms. Heather Stevenson, Mr. Michael O'Hagan, Mr. Charles Pollack, Clerk Shannon Westbrook, Personnel Services Director Pat Carson, acting as Assistant Clerk, and the public. The first item on the agenda is the adoption of the agenda. Do I have a motion to adopt?
Motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, the second item on the agenda is the selection of a chairman. Do I have a motion?
Move to elect Mr. O'Hagan as chairman.
I would move to elect Mr. Pollack as chairman.
I will second the nomination of Mr. Pollack, just in the interest of fairness.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, now I will turn the meeting over to Chairman Pollack.
Thank you. The only item on today's agenda is the investigatory review of the complaint filed by Mr. Rene Guidry against Commissioner Cindy Mills. Has everyone received a copy of the complaint and the response?
Yes.
Had a chance to review it?
Yes.
At least read it. Under the ethics ordinance, flipping through the correct section right now. It's section 14, subpart 3. It's like within 60 days of receiving a complaint, yet this panel shall conduct an investigatory review to determine whether specific, substantiated evidence from a creditable source exists to support a reasonable belief that there has been a violation of the code of ethics. That is the reason we are here today, to conduct that investigatory review. Westbrook, I have a question for you.
Sure.
Does the county, if you know, does the county have a policy about cell phone use, personal cell phone use? Is there county cell phones issued to elected officials?
I will consult with my assistant, who is the personnel services director.
Yes.
The elected officials are issued county cell phones, correct?
Yes, we do have a policy 20. I'll be glad to get you a copy of that if you'd like.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. And I think that Commissioner Mills brought this up in her response. Since the complaint doesn't actually allege any specific violations of the ethics ordinance, so I think it's up to us to determine if the violations that are alleged could constitute violation of the ethics ordinance.
Mm-hmm. Did you have any sense for that? I read that too.
So I guess the one that kind of jumps out to me as a possibility would be
Article 2, Section 2. I guess that'd be page 3.
Right. So I mean, it seems to me in general for all kind of service that you uphold the constitutional laws and legal regulations of the state. So, I mean, to me, yes, it does fall under this, but I think that's the initial.
That was the initial conclusion that I reached as well, is that I'm not sure if it's that section or there may be another section that it incorporates, but by reference. So I didn't think it was.
I think Article 3 actually was specific by
right.
The commissioner. So that's what, yeah.
Right.
But Section 1 of Article 3.
Yeah.
Uphold the constitutional laws, regulations of the United States, the state of Georgia, and the county, and all governments.
Left with what is our standard here today, because we're not to conduct an evidentiary hearing. It's not to determine.
Well,
I mean, I guess we've talked about it in the probable cause hearing in the past.
That's how I equate this.
Correct.
The probable cause.
Right.
Yeah, you know, the alleged violation, really, of the Open Records Act, which I think, if that's a violation, that's separate apart from what we're here to consider. That's for someone else to consider whether that act has been violated, but to the extent that may also constitute an ethical violation under the ethics code, that's the limitation of what we're here for.
Correct.
I think to say that a violation of state law would not also be a ethics violation is a stretch.
I would agree.
Or at least the claim of a violation. So, the complaint includes quite a bit of information from the county attorneys that they produced under the Open Records Act. Phone records and at least partial text messages, it looks like. Of course, we don't have both sides of it, so we'll be careful what kind of conclusions we draw from seeing what we've seen. That was really the basis of requesting a copy of the county's rules about cell phone use. When people, elected officials, conduct business kind of behind closed doors in that so-called smoke-filled room, it's, that's the kind of thing, it's partially what the ethics ordinance is trying to impact. So that we do conduct business upfront in the open.
So I guess the question is deleting text messages a violation of, and I understand that it's, we're not necessarily here to determine, but I could kind of, if the facts presented or proved to be true, does that constitute something that we deem to be a violation?
I think that's exactly the question. And then statement, I don't know where this is from, I'm thinking it's from maybe a Facebook page. Although I believe it was mentioned in the response, where Ms. Mills says that my text is deleted automatically. You know, just because it says that, and just because that happens, doesn't mean that's the right way to do it.
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't mean it's not a violation of the county ordinance or the policy. Texts and phone messages, or phone records, are county issued phone use or her personal phone? I mean, there's a lot that's redacted, so I'm thinking maybe it's a personal phone.
Well, it says that they have to redact
anything unrelated to.
Yeah. So.
Oh.
And there was a few numbers that could be identified,
right.
I think.
Right. So would this be from the county issued device, do you think?
I think so.
I mean, I'm looking, at the top of the bill, it starts page 28 to 53. Would be probably somewhat unusual for an individual to have a 53-page long cell phone bill on your phone. Though I guess it's not possible. It was produced by the county.
Yes, what I was having a hard time wrapping my head around is where, whether there are definitely messages that were deleted that were between these individuals or auto-deleted, and I don't know that much about the technology of our phone. If it does auto-delete, what? I don't know if she could have the more of a county storage issue. Or need another method for retaining that.
Yeah. I don't know either. I would think that this post could be a violation of the county's policy because it says that the text delete automatically without distinguishing whether the text that should be preserved under the county ordinance, the retention policy, or whether it shouldn't be, or whether it even matters. It's just sort of indiscriminately deleted automatically without any consideration of the subject matter being discussed.
Sure,
in the text.
Sure.
That's, I have a problem with that because she's taking a position that is a violation of the code.
I mean, I don't disagree with that, but I guess my question is, they're obviously not all deleted, because we're looking at some of them.
Right.
So, I guess, our determination is, do we think it's probable that texts of evidentiary value that would violate were in fact deleted? And I guess I don't know where we're supposed to find evidence of that other than just his affidavit, which I don't know if that's sufficient. I'm not saying it's not, I just don't know.
Mm-hmm. And I would think the county would have to try to figure out how, what they would need to do so that they didn't auto-delete. But not really an issue for today.
I guess I keep coming back to the portion of the affidavit that says, Mrs. Mills has ongoing tech conversations with other board commissioners, zoning attorneys, with other business with the board, property brokers, with business planning with the board, registered lobbyists, etc. None of these conversations were saved. How do we know that?
And because I can't. I mean, I can sort of get an idea from the text messages what they were talking about, but some, there's names mentioned. I don't know who they're talking about.
I don't think we could tell
whether
these messages that were partial messages should have been retained or not retained.
Right.
And I think that gets to a violation of whether or not it actually violates the record act, which I'm not sure that's what we're here to determine, but at the same time, I'm not sure how you get around making that determination if we're going to say that it's a violation of the ethics order, and if you violate state law.
Well, let's look at the affidavit, because there's several things mentioned in it. The first one is, and kind of putting aside the specific issues that the board was considering, the zoning case or whatever it may be, he says, it came to my knowledge that it's an email as opposed to business on her personal phone instead of using the taxpayer providing the county phone. So as to that, and then getting back to the phone or electronic use policy, this just deals with county policy. We didn't really see anything in the county policy
requiring that
county
phone be used for all
be
county.
Used for county business.
Right. It just says don't do the opposite.
Right.
Right. It says if you're using a county phone, then all this applies.
There is a section on personal use.
That's when using any electronic county property.
Is there any policy that deals with kind of the flip side of that, that requires county officials to use county issued phones?
For conducting county business.
I do not believe that.
Or prohibits personal phones for county business when they're issued a county phone.
The only thing I think I'm close to is this mobile device provision under section 3 where it says that an employee may carry a personal mobile device during work hours. The use of personal mobile devices for personal business must be during non-working hours, which to me would indicate you could use a personal one for business purposes during working hours. So I don't see any evidence that the first paragraph is in fact a violation of, because she's just using the personal phone. I don't necessarily think that's a violation. Now, she would obviously need to be subject to the record retention policy while doing so, but.
What if it's a county issued phone?
Okay.
Then, obviously, this would apply record retention requirements, this meeting, the policy 20 regarding electronic communication devices. And the record retention policy would also apply.
Now, to be clear, my understanding is that the record retention policy would apply regardless of whether it was a personal phone, as long as the business was, in fact, county business on it.
I think you're right, and actually I think the policy says that. It says mobile device records and content of its memory are subject to the Open Records Act.
Right.
So, again, back to the specific allegations in the affidavit. Paragraph 1, that she does business on the personal phone instead of the county-issued device. We've not seen anything where that's a violation of any county requirement. second one, in that same paragraph, she deletes text messages regardless of content. And that, he references the Facebook post. Looking at the response to see if there was anything specific that addressed the Facebook post, or denied it. The only thing I'm saying is just a mention of it, but not, and it's on page four.
Okay, I was gonna say, I remember seeing.
On page four, just a little bit below the middle of the page where it starts. I don't see anything saying that this is not an accurate post or denying the facts that may be contained in the post.
Right, this is not an analysis.
It just sort of acknowledges that it's there. And so it's just a conclusory statement not supported by evidence. Really a mistake, I'm almost thinking that if it's something from her Facebook page and they're not denying that's where it came from, then that's sort of acknowledging that is what it is. We'll come back to that. Yes. The next paragraph of the affidavit. Had ongoing text conversations with other commissioners, zoning attorneys, property brokers, business before the board, etc., and none of them were saved despite requirement to do so.
How do we know that?
We have absolutely no knowledge
right.
of that based on what we've seen. I think that probably does fall within the no specific supporting evidence.
Well, I guess there is evidence of the text messages that were actually supplied are between Ms. Mills and another member of the board.
Yeah. Well, I don't know.
Well,
because all it says is received from or sent to. It doesn't say to the other parties, Mark.
Right, but if it's in response to an Open Records Act, I guess we need to see what the specific documents were of the Open Records Act proposed. Well, in the back, there's, I mean, at least I know that's the county attorney that she's having a conversation
right.
with.
Right.
So.
Right, that, yeah. And there are some other names when it's been group messaged.
Right.
I don't know who those people are. And the message has handwritten executive in both places. So we don't know what the content of it was.
Well, I mean, my understanding somewhere that it was executive, it was redacted because it was subject to
executive.
Yeah. So we do know she's communicating with commissioners. I would and the county attorney. However, the fact that it alleges none of these conversations were saved is obviously untrue, and we're looking at some of them.
All of the fairly recent, from, I mean, within, not recent, but within the same timeframe, January 10th.
To the 31st, I think.
To January 31st.
So then moving to the next paragraph.
I don't know what he requested in the directions. The letter says pursuant to our letter of February 23rd, which we don't have.
I guess if I go back to the affidavit, the third paragraph says, attaches a summary of the text messages, which shows multiple evidentiary messages that should have been retained. Well, if they're attached, how were they not retained? They're retained somewhere.
That, and then the next set of phone records showing calls back and forth is outside the period of when these text messages are.
Right.
So I guess if we had information showing what time text messages were sent back and forth, and then could show that there were text messages sent and then nothing attached, then we would know that, yes, something was deleted. Short of that, I don't know that we could.
Which, I mean, we obviously see that text messages were sent, we just don't know if they were deleted or not because
but these are,
we don't know what the open records request actually
requested.
Right.
All we have is the response.
But these phone records look May.
The letter sending the phone record copies is dated January 6th, so obviously it would have been before.
Right.
And then the ones, the partial text messages start January 4th, the one on the very last page, to January 30th. So it would have been after this letter was sent, and then it looks like there was another letter on March 1st that was transmitting these records. But it also looks like Mr. Guidry sent an open records request sometime before January, and then a second one on February 20th.
Right. And the first one gives us places called on certain dates. And then the second thing gives us text messages from later dates. But it doesn't show who was being, we can't link up whether or not anything was specifically deleted because we don't know what texts were sent on certain days that are or are not contained within the text messages. So I guess I don't, you know, my thing is I don't know that they weren't deleted.
That's what I'm thinking, is that when the memory fills up, the old ones start deleting. but there's nothing in place to save them. And again, it's totally indiscriminate from the content of the message. So it could be a message that should be retained, but it may not be. And there's no way of, there's no way of telling.
Which, I guess, to me, that's starting to get more into an evidentiary hearing portion of it. I think what we're supposed to do today is look at what do we have, and do we believe that what we have necessitates having an evidentiary hearing?
Well, the question then is there, reading from the ethics ordinance, is there specific substantiated evidence from a creditable source to support a reasonable belief, that reasonable belief, that there's been a violation of the code, of the ethics code? That's kind of the ultimate question.
Well, he has alleged that she has deleted conversations of evidentiary value. We don't necessarily know, I don't know that, just the allegation of that would be enough, but she has stated she does indiscriminately delete text messages. She has not denied that, which to me indicates.
We're still back to
My sense is, putting aside whether it's a zoning issue or some other county issue, if a complaint was filed and the complaint said that Commissioner Mills is violating the ethics code by having a policy of deleting all text messages, period, that would probably be enough to get to the next point of saying, you know, this policy, this personal policy of deleting all text messages is not what the county ordinance requires.
Right.
In terms of either the retention policy or if it's a county issued cell phone that these messages appear on. And is that really what his complaint, is that the essence of this gentleman's complaint? And then whatever he provided in terms of the Facebook post being specific and substantiated, well, it's specific, it says what it says. And is it substantiated? Well, her response to the complaint made note of the policy and didn't contradict what he said. We're not here to reach an ultimate conclusion.
Right.
And is it a credible source? Well, when you look at the complaining party and you look at the responding party, and no one is saying that this is a fake news story or a fake post or not true or not really what happens, maybe that makes it a credible source, and maybe it supports that reasonable belief that there's been a violation. And at least enough to go to the next step.
I think you may be right. It's just that
I'm not sure how to meet the burden of proof at the next step, but I tend to agree with you that I think that it's been mentioned.
Yeah, and you know, if they auto-delete, you know, it's based on this Facebook post, I don't think it's her, hey, I've been sitting on this for a month, let me get rid of it. I think they sit in the phone and tell the phone decides to delete them. So, no, I mean, I would agree with her.
I'm not saying there's anything nefarious going on.
Sure.
Right.
We've probably all been there where, you know, you look at how much memory your phone's using, and it's like, wow, I'm using that much for just old text messages.
Right. So I would tend to think there's enough to at least get to the next level. Whether there's an intentional violation, I don't, that's not for today. Presumably the county needs to do something about how they change the storage. But again, that's not for us today.
We don't know if they do or don't.
Right, exactly. We need to, we haven't even gotten that evidence. But yeah, I tend to think that there's enough here to recommend an evidentiary hearing.
I just don't want to make that a motion.
I motion to recommend at this point proceed to an adjournment.
I would second.
All in favor?
Aye.
So that, I believe, addresses the one issue on our agenda today. Someone make a motion to adjourn.
Well, before we do adjourn.
Yes.
Just to let you know that upon adoption of today's meeting minutes, via email, the payment will be issued to Mrs. and Mr. Logan's Pollack. And of course, I'll make contact to set up a pay for the adjournment.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Meeting adjourned.
Aye.
Meeting adjourned at 11:12.
Yes, Charles.
C-H-A-R-L-E-S.
Yes, Pollack. P-O-L-L-A-C-K.
P-O-L-L-A-C-K.
I mean, who the heck can do that?
I'm sorry, no, it's okay. Can I get your first name, Stevenson?
H-E-A-G-H-E-R.
Oh, thank you.
S-O-N, S-T-E-V-E-N-S-L-N.
Okay, perfect. No, you're good.
Mike.
And my K-E.
Yeah, O'Hagan. O-H-A-G-A-N. I just said what G-A-S.
Perfect. Okay, so. Okay, perfect. And then. Can I get your first name?
I was just going to say the impression she was. Can I get your first name, please?
Charles.
Charles. Thank you.
What did you say after the motion that couldn't?
Nice to meet you.
This is two zones.
Okay, so I just came here. Thanks. And then one more question. If I had to get the complaint and the response.
I know, I was like.
Yeah. Alright, thank you.
They understand those that the legal term of sanctions say that here's what I think happens to anticipate. But good job.
Thank you.
She wanted me to get a picture of Cindy.
Here, let me get a picture of you. Here, I can.
Sorry, no, I was going to ask you a question.
Yep, right here, we got it. There's one, there's two, there's three. Gotcha.
Hey, Pat.
Excuse me.
Next round.
Yes. Yes. I don't think they want to listen, so that's why.
Right.
Yes, yes, and it is a bit on the internet.
Right.
Oh, I'm just getting ready to get the same thing.
And that's why that's where we went to just bring one out.
Right, and that is sometimes how the process goes, but.
Wow, that was interesting.
And I told you, you had a power thing next year.
Comes up when you write something. So I just emailed you the request.
That all came out of three things. It's a lot of these, like sanctions, the lines of sanctions for Cindy.
Okay.
Alright.
Rene.
Lunch.
Is the one?
What time is it?
I'm here to work.
Okay.
He's got it. They just give you.
I know, I will, I'll try, there it is. Okay, thank you, I appreciate it.
Sure.
Thank you.
Sure, let's do it.
It's very.
Okay.
Non-legal person to prosecute someone for a state process.
Okay. Any other points that I need to talk?
Okay.
Sure, too.
See and understand the mistakes and pressure in the process. It'll be a lot better once we go to the actual trial. And I'm able to verbally explain myself.
All of the things that they were throwing out.
Okay, so but how do you feel at least that the decision, you know, that's moving forward?
I'm happy so far. We'll
we'll see the general outcome, but it's progressing as I expected.
Yeah.
And then I guess you can just tell me a little bit about what you're wanting to do the next step, how that goes. Just your thoughts on it.
Ultimately, I'm gonna give out the evidence, and the ethics board to make a determination, and I'll abide by whatever determination they have. I have no general hope or anything for the outcome that's beyond my scope.
Absolutely, okay.
I think that should take care of what I need. One thing I was wondering, do you have any of the copies of the documents? That you might be able to send to us or anything?
Yeah, I can give it to you.
Okay, yeah. And do you have my email?
Yeah.
I'll watch the.
Yeah. It's all good.
This is just.
Oh, I've seen the ABC News videos before.
What, jumping?
Yes, I believe.
I try not to, yeah, I don't hear, but.
Do you want a copy of the complaint and everything?
Yes.
Okay. Will you, if you have any questions about the complaint, ask me before you publish something halfway. So it's happened before.
So what you just explained to me was interesting, where the way you obtained those deleted messages, because those messages, text messages, were sent by Cindy to another commissioner, who then supplied you with those text messages. So therefore, correct, and they were unable to determine that, but that was real, that was key.
Yeah, when you hear them talking about it, you know, I wrote a legal brief, and I'm not a lawyer, so they were struggling over the text message. You'd be like, well, he says they're deleted, but here they are. Those were from another commissioner showing what she had deleted. Because I made the initial request for her, and they said, these are deleted. Went to another commissioner, and they said, here's the text messages. And they showed conversations between commissioners that need to be retained, proof of executive session that were redacted of information that needed to be retained, et cetera. But they come out to them, but ultimately, we got what we wanted.
But now it will. Now it'll have an opportunity. Good job. Good job.
Thank you, Shannon. Thank you.
Yeah, man. Thank you.
Sweating bullets.
No, you're fine, man. That was great. You did. You got the next one.